Good afternoon. Thank you all for coming. This is the second, I believe, of the Global Health Seminar of the South Asia Institute here at Harvard. And I am Jinah Kim. I am Assistant Professor of History of Art and Architecture here on campus. And I'm here to introduce our speaker today. And it took me a while to actually understand your biography, actually, because being a layperson, I'm not a medical specialist. As you can see from my title, I'm an art historian. And for me to actually sort of understand even a short biography of Dr. Salins took me a while to actually sort of understand what his contributions really meant. I really wanted to understand it. So I went did Google search and actually had to search for the terms. And anyway, so Dr. Paul Salins is a medical director and vice president of the Mazumdar Show Cancer Center and Narayana Hrudayalaya Multi-Specialty Hospital. And this is in Bangalore, I believe.
Yes.
And this is one of the biggest cancer center projects in the world. He's an internationally acclaimed authority in the specialty of cranial maxillofacial surgery. And this term actually made me look it up because I, kind of got the sense, but it's not the everyday term that I use. And my understanding is this actually means he's a specialist surgeon on the areas of face, skull, jaw, and neck, right? Is that correct?
Yes, yes.
So, right. Anything beyond neck up, you go to Dr. Salins. His surgical innovations and perspectives have been much acclaimed internationally. And some of the key contributions made by Dr. Salins includes the technique of nasal orbital maxillary transposition, which actually, again, led me to search for this term, which led to his 1998 article on this technique that really sort of contributes to allowing surgeons and oncologists to access the lesions that are way behind facial surface intercranial areas that are not otherwise not accessible. And he is a specialist on many, so he has devised many techniques and treatment techniques dealing with very severe deformities and facial asymmetries. And one thing I could actually understand what it is, and he developed also an emergency room angiographic technique for visualization of major head and neck vessels. And this would be a life-saving technique when it comes to emergency room application. And if this is sort of kind of still abstract about his contributions to the medical world and surgery, I did sort of run a search on his name on the US National Library of Medicine, and PubMed search engine reveals 17 articles authored by Dr. Salins, widely cited and acclaimed. So that's sort of academic translation of his contributions. So we have a great surgeon scholar here today as a speaker. And he also have key contributions in facial aesthetic surgery, and his surgical work has restored self-respect and self-esteem of many people with deformities and mutilations of the facial region. And Dr. Salins not only is an expert surgeon, he has helped many medical institutions in India and abroad to connect globally, and he's a pioneer in creating a global health network. And his current research interest is in the area of engineering applications of modeling-based decision-making processes to surgical practices. So all this is great contributions as a doctor and medical director, but while making contributions to the medical world at a global level, he also kept a significant interest in art and music. I was glad to find that he studied art history at Cambridge University. To my disappointment, he didn't pursue it as his professional career choice, but I should not be disappointed given the number of patients, medical professionals, and medical institutions that are grateful to Dr. Salins' pioneering contributions in medical field on daily basis. So But I'm glad that nonetheless studying art history seems to have inspired his keen interest in art. And I'm looking forward to today's talk on sort of art and science of facial surgery, the title of which is on here. And without further delay, I present to you Dr. Paul Salins.
Thank you so much for this introduction. I'm just recovering my breath after this long, rather tedious taxi journey. The topic is somewhat like my art is rather convoluted the way I will consider it, because the melange of art and science in the practice, I think the art is very, very important. Before Gaya thought, I thought, this is where I live when I'm not working, up in the mountains, as you can see, just slightly above the clouds. So your oxygenation of the brain is slightly hypoxic, so you tend to be very imaginative, so art automatically flows. So just to give an introduction and I'm very grateful to thank you so much for the introduction, and Tarun Khanna for inviting me to be here. It's a great pleasure for me to be here. And I know South Asian studies. And our institution has made a contribution in creating accessible or affordable healthcare. So I thought I will just give you a brief introduction about our institution. Narayana Hrudayalaya was founded by Dr. Devi Shetty. Here he is. He's a cardiac surgeon. And he came back and he was working in Calcutta. With the Birlas, and he never thought of treating because, A, he thought there are so many poor people with cardiac disease and cardiac surgery is so expensive, even if you were to treat them, it would not really make any difference. So there was no point in wasting time trying to make it affordable or accessible. And also he thought that the cardiac surgery is so expensive to make it available to many is simply an impossible task. Then he met Mother Teresa, and something that she said, which actually transformed him, I think is very relevant. He said, when she said, Mother, you know, because she kept asking him, why don't you do something for the poor? And he said, really, it is impractical and it is impossible to do. And it would not make a big difference. He said, she said, it is not very important that you are making a difference to them, but it will make a difference to you if you really start doing something for the poor. Then he said, Mother, can't you be reasonable? How can we afford to do cardiac surgery for the poor? She said, as long as you are doing something for the poor, you will never run out of resources. And with these two things, of course, he started this hospital, and over a period of time, we were able to reduce the cost of cardiac surgery with the same outcomes to almost $1,000 with a lot of innovations, and more than that, create a fantastic, vibrant, and a very exciting way of practicing medicine, which laid the foundation for Narayana Hrudayalaya. And then 5 years ago, Kiran Mazumdar, she's an entrepreneur and one of the very vibrant, as you can see, I managed to do things with a lot of common sense, a lot of determination, a lot of foolish courage. This is the motto of Dr. Mazumdar. She had also an encounter because one of her very close friends had cancer of the breast. And the way she passed away and all the difficulties she had made Kiran recognized that there was also a great need for oncological work in India. So that laid the foundation for the Mazumdar Shaw Cancer Center, which subsequently became one of the very large cancer institutes with a huge focus on research. This is the institute. 5 years ago, I took up this responsibility, and I realized that in cardiac and ophthalmology and even orthopedics and several specialties and oncology, if you really want to create an affordable or an accessible healthcare, there is a hierarchy of possibilities. It is possible in certain, because there is, as I said, I think I put four criteria, potential for cure within a reasonable time. How many modalities are required for diagnosis and treatment? What is the overall disease burden that is existing in this particular specialty? And perception of seriousness. If you say it is cardiac, everybody is worried about. And cancer, if you say, people are afraid, but their commitment to it becomes, because they're too afraid. So there needs to be a threshold where people become proactive. While cardiac, everybody feels, because the cure is possible. So we created two institutions. One, of course, looking at numbers, cost reduction, and sort of production line process, and something that will evolve easily into transferable systems. While in the multi-specialty and the oncology center, we focused on what is called a nested oncology center, where the multi-specialty provides a large platform on which the oncology can survive. Then we also realized that in hospitals, multi-specialty integration is a very critical factor. I'll touch upon that afterwards, because nowadays every specialty has a life of its own, and it tries to sustain its own interests. So much so, a patient, I was speaking to a professor from MIT just in the afternoon, and he's giving the example of going with his wife in Singapore for a problem, a DVT or something like that. And he was describing that it took five specialists in one of the top hospitals before they could even get the conclusion that they were not sure what she had. So, and a huge battery of investigation. So integration, I think, is important, because the whole the specialty should come together to serve people. Then, of course, research, and then that comes to the cultural stimulus. This brings me to this very important, when Tarun asked me to think about this melange, some sort of a tension between science and art that exists in medicine. I realized that it is indeed true that something is missing in the overall way in which we practice medicine, and art probably is a very important role, and that's why I thought it would be worthwhile talking about it. Now, this I put to illustrate, this is the how the Birmingham University was founded by Josiah Mason, and this is the lecture that Thomas Huxley gave. I want you to read this. It's very interesting. He said, "For I hold very strongly by two convictions. The first is that neither the discipline of the subject matter of classical education is of such direct value to the student of physical science as to justify the expenditure of valuable time upon either. And the second is that for the purpose of attaining real culture and exclusively scientific education, at least as effective as exclusively literary education." So the focus was to be on science alone. And his argument is, if you're a carpenter, you learn to cut wood. You do not have to really have a large investment on anything else. And the rebuttal to this was given by Matthew Arnold. I mean, I won't go into this. It's a fascinating story. In fact, Huxley and Matthew Arnold were great friends. And I think what he said about it is very true, also of nations and also specialties, that if you really want something, create something which has a direct relevance to humanity, then I think it's important that you have to integrate art and science. And whatever the tension there is in the integration of this, they have to be overcome. That's why I was very, very fascinated to read that in the 1969 student riot, some of the things they said, that the classes are getting boring and there is no poetry in the classes. So I realize, you know, there is a sort of feeling that there has to be aesthetics and art which is actually motivating a lecture. So in order to illustrate this aspect of art which animates medicine and makes it different, I'm putting this picture. This is a picture by Sir Luke Fields. And as you know, this was also a picture which became the slogan in the 60s for the American Medical Association. And it's a very important picture when they said, when nationalizing medicine in the United States, they used this picture to illustrate that by nationalizing, they were actually moving away from this scene of a surgeon or a physician being part and parcel of the family and being integrated into the whole process. While I tried to put what is a family doctor's current Google research, and I found this type of pictures, which actually are a completely different, you can see what a tremendous shift has taken place in the way we view the practice of medicine in the past and now. And I think the reason we integrate the two is to create a certain degree of way of functioning which is very humanistic, which has direct relevance to man. In fact, much of the things that we do, particularly with focusing on science, tends to detach you from humanity in the practice of medicine, certainly. There is a great need that your interest directly corresponds to what we are trying to do with people. So I have put the three elements to the whole process: the art of medical practice, and art is necessary to nurture and animate and create a certain creative tension in the field of medicine or any endeavor of science. And then, of course, there is a whole science of art as a component of healing. I deliberately put this, I just made it up, but I think it illustrates some of the points. See, art, our understanding of the human body and mind is very limited. So there needs to be a connection which actually makes it possible, and art can play, or a practice of medicine which inculcates. Human suffering is purely subjective. And that is why if you really want to understand what somebody is going through, by detachment it is not possible. It is important that you connect with them. So a purely scientific endeavor will not be able to do that. Cure can be mechanical, but at best medicine should be cure and care, because the whole concept of healthcare or any sort of a doctor's relationship to a suffering patient, if it incorporates cure and care, then of course you have a process of healing which is more than just a correction of symptoms or correction of some of the anomalies which have occurred, but really the holistic understanding of a human being and getting into them and sorting it out. And that requires not just a mechanical process of practice of medicine, but an art. Only art in medical practice depends on the highest level of cognition and creative tension. If you really want to understand the subtle differences that actually cause disease, very often it is very easy, because of modern pharmacology and understanding of pathology, to treat a particular condition. But very often, whether it is hypertension or diabetes, and all these conditions are because there is something that is not on the surface. Because there are always other factors. Sometimes when you talk to a patient, you discover that the family tensions, problems, difficulties, and incompatibilities are the reason. So holistically getting all this into the picture and treating them is an art. It cannot be a science. And I have put creation of intrinsic rewards. One of the greatest merits of earlier medical practice, when it was more of an art, when we connected, when there were so many things which you had to grasp instinctively, was the intrinsic rewards. To be a doctor was a fantastic thing. When I was developing some of the techniques which we mentioned, the fun of it was that, you know, it was a discovery. Why did we do it? Because we wanted to help a patient. We are connected, and the situation seemed impossible unless there was a frisson, a sort of an innovative capacity. It was impossible to do. So in medical science, of course, improves understanding, enables us to do cures, but I don't think it has the capacity to heal, as I've illustrated. It reduces man to many small and often detached parts. And I think that's one of the biggest problems. Technology aims to reduce human cognitive burden and detaches doctor from the patient. the more science we bring into it, the less is the cognitive burden of the patient on the doctor. It is, and ultimately, it is indifferent with regard to goals. That's why I just put this to illustrate that here is a ordinary scenery, but when a great artist takes it, it is transformed. So I think bringing a science and art together creates a certain capacity to view things in a different perspective. And you see, I very often look at it, and if you see the earlier one. So quickly taking you through the concept of how medicine was practiced. Earlier, there was the factory, industry, and workplace. And we had surgery, medicine, and women and children. And a family physician took care of all the things, and he was part of the community. I put this picture from my own family's family album. There is my father and mother there. And this is how a community hospital was, you know. Many other people worked, and it was one of the happiest places. In fact, I really cherish the memories of my childhood as a doctor's son. It was a fantastic thing. Everybody was known to us. In fact, when we speak about genomics, I realized that my mother, because she knew the families of all the people in our community, could really make predictions about the probability of disease, mental disorders, and even very often when some disease would manifest in a particular family, because she understood the, at least the way the traits were passed on. And it is a science which is still is evolving. And then, of course, divisions had to take place because it is growth and it's inevitable through specialization. We had surgery and medicine, women and children. Workplaces also became more and more. Then there was further expansion into further subspecialties. And I very often feel that the community became encroached by work. So people lost their leisure and finally it went in. And that's why I wanted to make a distinction between division. This is expansion and division, and you can see here. This I will link it with whenever some expansion takes place, we go into a process of division that is very necessary. In facial surgery, this is a classical example. We divide the mandible, and it is because there's a disparity, a disharmony, and we do it to reconnect them in a proper harmonious fashion. So any specialization which is developing also requires a division, division for the optimal alignment. As you can see here, it improves the facial appearance significantly. Sometimes you need to divide because something which is growing in order to reorganize it. And here again, you see, here is a girl whose face has grown tremendously. And what I have done is we have reorganized the entire structure. Then again, sometimes we have to divide in order to put it, certainly in facial surgery, to put it in a very eccentric position because the harmony is lost. And as you can see here, you can actually produce tremendous changes in the facial posture. And sometimes even we have to divide in order to improve access. And that's why division itself is not a wrong process. And in this case, there is a tumor which is going under the skull. As you can see here, I have divided the face into small, small, small bits together. And then, as you can see here, reconnected them. This is 4 years later. She is very much alive and able to laugh and live together. And it has been made possible because it has we have learned how to divide things and put them back together in a format which is helpful. Here she is. One of my most favorite patients. And this is what we said, it is possible to do any sort of division because it is an orderly, organized event, it can be. So division into fields of specialization or abstraction specific for study or development. Then, of course, when these divisions, this one, I really feel in medicine what happened, gradually a sort of distension occurred and the connection to the community became lost. And later on, it actually went into fragmentation in the sense that you can see here, there's a huge number of specialties, each one with its own life of its own, and each one looking after its own affairs. And fragmentation is different. As I showed you earlier, this is a typical case of a trauma who walks in, and you can see everything fragmented because it is not a calculated movement. And even if you actually put him together, as you can see here, because the fragment is so gross, he has lost both his eyes. We are able to put his shape back, but there is some loss. So fragmentation inevitably produces sequestration, and each one becomes its own character. And ultimately, as you can see here, this leads to problems. So divisions into fields of specialization or abstraction, specific problems to study, fragmentation to break down, ascribe divisions in arbitrary fashion. In fact, this is very much like the way cancer spreads, where it actually starts spreading, but without any organization. So the whole problem in a tertiary hospital that we find one of the biggest challenges we have is a hospital is simply a conglomeration of specialties which are completely having an independent agenda, and they do not connect with each other sufficiently. And there is nowhere in the whole premise a place for the patient as a whole. So it's very difficult to recognize what the problems are. Suppose you go with a stomachache, you are going to gastroenterology. And if you say that you are a diabetic, you are sent to a diabetology. So the holistic care of the patient, which is the premise on which healthcare should be organized, unfortunately is fragmented. And then economic pressures also come. This hospital, I feel that it is actually floating on a very, 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 very turbulent sea run by medical technology. We were discussing in the afternoon number of challenges that we face, and also then there is a huge financial burden because these hospitals involve a huge amount of investment, particularly if you are going to do this. And then, of course, the healthcare business offers the bait of money. So that actually creates a completely a different stream of healthcare. So as I said, the integration of art, and I think it is a great loss that art has gone out of surgery. I just wanted to say there are two factors which really made the art disappear from the practice of medicine. One is the focus of technology. As you can see here, key aim of modern diagnostic and therapeutics is reduce cognitive load of clinicians, make medicine more objective. Objective leads to dependence on predictability, and then we have the indifference to the exception and unexplained. See, the most of the great discoveries in medicine occurred because of the exception. And you find that something does not fit into the normal module. And from that, you are able to create a very, very interesting concepts. And unfortunately, nowadays, because it's an evidence base, this is reduced. Cognitive burden and cognitive dependence is reduced. That's why medicine begins to suffer. That's why medical practice degenerates into activism, being in control, and depends. So much of the problem, I really feel, is because that's why I have put it as tyranny of pure evidence-based medical practice. If this is from David Bohm, if science always insists that a new order must be immediately fruitful, that it has some predictive power, then creativity will be blocked. Earlier, I think much of the development, if it's the history of medicine, it is because people were able to really work out things because their focus was the patient, and ultimately they had to find out. Most of us who actually lived through the last 30 years, we enjoyed our medical practice because there was always opportunities for development. So I have put it here. Earlier we all had a halo, now it has been removed. So the medical practitioner naturally has no other choice to go but to become a mercenary, and when we blame the medical practitioner. That is why probably we have come into a situation where we have to make a distinction between the part of the medical practice which involves art, human effort, and a certain degree of excellence as a human being. And then separate it from another whole group of medical practice which probably can be taken over by technology. And I think if we do that, probably we'll have a much more sensible practice. Instead of asking doctors to go to the village, you actually say that, okay, they cannot go to the village, but is there really the need for somebody? Because as it is, most of it. Because when we undermine the human capacity, undermine the contribution of man, always it degenerates into some sort of a negative practice, and that is exactly what I noticed has occurred. Art of medical practice, art to nurture creativity in medicine, art promoting healing. I will now go into the second part. Art is all about educating the perception. In what way does art play a role in the education or in the way medical practice is directed? And I think one very important factor is educating perception. I thought of putting few examples. This is Rembrandt. One of the things that fascinates me, he was such a nasty soul, and you can actually go around and see one of the, as a facial surgeon, one of the great studies which fascinates me always is how over the different periods of time he is very faithful in representing his inner emotion. And it's fascinating. And it is 1916-69 when I think he had got his mistress, who was admitted in the mental asylum, thrown her out and caused an absolute havoc. And after that, you see, you know, everything is deflated. Here is a defeated man. And in fact, sometimes when I ponder this, I think if a clinical medicine has to be learned, I think one of the places where you will really get a perception about the inner soul of man, what really drives and animates man, I think you need to really look at art. Similarly, Van Gogh, when he has schizophrenic feelings, you have all this, but it is Van Gogh's picture of his mother. And I really love that picture because, you know, you really find a different sort of personality represented there. And I think we suffer a great deal because perception needs to be educated, because the way the brain functions is very interesting. The input into the visual cortex, what goes in, is small, but the output is enormous, in several times more than what goes in, indicating that we seem to put a great deal of stimulus into the way we perceive things. That is to be, if that has to be educated, there has to be a process of exposure. Another thing that really, I always wondered, Dalai Lama always fascinates me. How did he look as a young man? Because when I treat young people, I have to have a perception about how they would be in years to come and how life would imprint them. And here is Gandhi. In fact, if you see Gandhi's early pictures, you would be amazed. He had some of the most bizarre hairstyles you can imagine. I went to his home and looked at some of his early pictures. Unfortunately, I couldn't find it. But you see, experience writes it, and that's a very important education. I can go on, we can scientifically discuss the implications about how right side of the brain, left side of the brain, how the integration of the two is very important as a substrate for creative thought, but I think it is. So that brings me to the second point quickly, art to nurture creativity in medicine or any endeavor of science, I think. See, thought has played, this is David Bohm. I think he is one of the most important persons who has analyzed the process of creative thought. I always, if science insists that a new order must be, I've already told this, but new thoughts generally arise with the play of mind, and failure to appreciate this is one of the major blocks to creativity. So, this is a picture I myself made thinking about it, because the whole spectrum of things that actually animate a scene, you know, there are so many things. I very often imagine the mind to be full of different games being played at the same time. So, I've been just going into it. We have input and association, output and application, and augmented output, which I already just briefly, it is. So basically cognitive processes, this needs to be educated. So I will quickly illustrate, even in medicine, in diagnostics or anything, you have to have the capacity to create new generative orders, because after all, what is a picture? It is few lines. But the few lines an artist creates a generative order which contains highly complex dynamic hierarchy of orders, lines, forms, meanings, and so on. So actually you build layer by layer, one over the other, constituting a meaning. And so in order to do that, I thought, let me work out the generative order. So I drew this particular picture on a graph paper and do it in such a way that you can also, if you put it sideways. Then I thought I will call all my assistants to put color. And as you can see, we got, by the time we were through it, you see, there is so much. And in fact, it is the picture that sits in my office, and everybody admires it. Actually, it is a collective effort. And as you can see, the possibility of generative orders developing and how the mind creates multiple levels of thought, and it expresses it. And this is an immense...
Go back to the black and white one for a minute. And they took that.
Yeah. And you can see, here it is. It's not just the color, you see, but they have put... One example I'll tell you is putting meaning into the substance of this is here. My assistant finally said, well, it is so complex, there is no human element. I would like to put a door. There has to be an entry into this maze of complexity. And I said, well, I'm a little bit schizoid, so, you know, it's... So we have put a door there, and actually it is a beautiful picture. And I love it, and it sits in front of my office because it really indicates how generative orders are created, how art can be even a collective effort which animates the processes of thought. Then, I think this is a very important one because we spoke about generative orders, so it is possible for everybody to create some sort of generative order. What sets apart, while the mediocre are content to pursue their habits of mind and do not have sufficient passion and create beyond generative schema that went before, the great artist is able to perceive the world in new ways and create fresh orders. I think it is very, very important because most, whether it is the practice of medicine or the practice probably of any endeavor, there is a tacit infrastructure of ideas which bind us to one way of thinking. And I think never, other than in art, I think we see how the whole schema undergoes a tremendous transformation. And if one has to develop that sort of a energy in thinking, it is, for instance, we have the face. Here, Leonardo da Vinci's the ugly face and the beautiful face. So I said, okay, let me try. This is after Scheele. So I went around and drew a picture. Then when you see the original, you realize, you know, what a fantastic it is. So you can see how the generative order changes. But to me, having done one and the other, when I compare the two, it's a tremendous creative and educational exercise, which makes it possible to appreciate more. Similarly, here Matisse and Rembrandt, you can see how a creative mind can produce two pictures of the face, but each one so full of life. But it is actually the genre of representation is quite different. Then here comes, of course, Picasso. It looks very, very simple, but then, of course, it has gone into another form of a generative order. It is. Now, here is this particular picture where, of course, I think he put himself in the picture. So if you actually divide it, it is. So it's a fascinating picture of his mistress and himself. So I said, why not I do this? So me and my assistants, we did a little exercise. Here we are. As you can see here, it has a combination of the composite. But of course, it is it is nothing new because we are really actually experimenting with a form. But then in clinical medicine, that becomes a very important way of perceiving things and creating generative order from that. So I want to see how this connects. Is terminology of healing has been replaced by cure, but do or not? So I just want you to read this because this actually illustrates so many, we have technology, all these things, it has slowly separated us from it is. That's why whenever the art of medicine is loved, there is also the love of humanity. That's why I think the scientific detachment and taking the art component out of the practice of medicine is probably the root cause of much of the problems that we are now compelled to face. Because if you really do not have intrinsic rewards in the endeavors that we pursue, that we are not doing something because you love to do it, then it actually goes into other things. That's why I'm very, very happy to know that Nadella is a person who has a tremendous interest in Walt Whitman and Auden and poetry. So I realized that, you know, one of the great things that characterizes a vibrant thought process is metaphoric thinking, and certainly poetry is the exercise in metaphors, and that fits in with the whole understanding. I will finish this one, and see, if you consider the face, we can think of it in architectural schema, and as you can see, all the face, irrespective of what animal it is, they all have a mouth, a nose, eyes and ear, because, and all of them occupy a high position, because the schema works very well. There is no reason to change it. And then there is morphological units, you know, each one, the lip and each component here, which actually, but it is possible to create attractiveness artificially. This is the computer image. Such a person does not exist, but if you see this picture, same one has been converted into a more attractive one, and you know what are the parameters on which they can be done. So there are different elements you can incorporate, which are called neoteny, maturity, expressiveness. I'll quickly go through this. Neoteny is the features of a child: large forehead, large wide set eyes, small nose and chin. Then we have the mature properties. You know, in the male, it is prominent male eyes, wide mandibles, strong chin, thin lips. Then, of course, expressive or responsive. So in different proportions it is possible for us. Then of course there is some concepts of beauty based on the analysis. But can we take these concepts and build up a face? The answer is yes. So I have a great friend of mine. This lady came to me many years ago now. She has a few children. She said, my face is very boring. And she was a very attractive girl. And she said, well, I do not know, when people actually talk to me, they do not talk to me, you know, somehow they miss my spirit, she said. I said, well, but what am I to do for this? I mean, you go to a psychologist and get yourself better. But she said, no, I think it is to do with my face. And when I looked at it, I mean, it did look a little bit dull. And so we said, okay, I did a little research. And we said, okay, what sort of face would you like? I thought this was easier to achieve because I just need to. And what sort of face? So I gave her a few choices. Unfortunately, I tried to persuade her to go for this, but she said she wanted this. And there we are. So we did a little work, and there she is, and then she is. And of course, she became a very, very attractive person.
And can you tell what you did? I mean, how many procedures did she need?
Actually, I did only one procedure because...
You did all at once?
All at once in her case, yes.
So what was the organizing principle to change her face in that?
She was quite tall, so I knew that I could elongate her face to give the impression. And I narrowed, I just moved this forward so that earlier she had a squarish one, so I increased it by 6 millimeters and converted it into a triangular face. I augmented her lips and, I think lifted the fat from here toward the zygoma. It was not a big surgery, but it was very effective. And I asked her to change her hairstyle and move her eyebrows up, and so she was, it is. Now, this sort of a concept is nothing unusual, because even if you see in, Neolithic plaster, they knew how to actually fit a skull with a face and what to do with it. And this is the sort of in Egypt, if you see, this is sort of the Roman soldiers who were here and there used to go and have their pictures sent home, like a small portrait. And they had actually perfected the way of making everybody look good. There was a formula to it. And I don't think he was as good as that, but you know, they put features of Neoteny and all these things to make him look good. And so we actually have a study. This study actually is all these people are there. You are supposed to measure who has success. And you would be quite amazed how biased we could get by looking at these faces. So that does make sense that there is an opportunity to change faces into it. So Lincoln, we do not see him like this. This was actually a picture of how he was. And as you can see here, in all the pictures, it was slightly modeled, I gather, to make him look slightly different. And therefore, you know, it is a feature probably which will have, I call it a utilitarian concept of beauty. Now, as you can see here, this is a very important article in political psychology. What they have done is what I've told you, neoteny, unaltered, mature. So they changed on the photograph the faces just a little bit, as you can see here, of Clinton, Kennedy, and Reagan. And they asked students at a university to mark them for different characteristics. You would be amazed at the impact it had. It's a fascinating article to read, where even the voter perception so significantly changed that with the small changes in Clinton's face, he was considered to be very, very, very affectionate, very honest, and so much of changes. So it is possible indeed. In study one, neutral features made Clinton seem to be honest, attractive, even to perceivers who did not support him in the 1996 election. Study two, mature features made Kennedy, the youngest, seem to be more cunning and made Reagan, the old president, appear less powerful and less warm. Neutralist features reduced ratings of both Kennedy's and Reagan's power, whereas neutralizing familiar face of Clinton increased ratings of his honesty and attractiveness without diminishing perceptions of his power. So this is really a science. I think the next area that we are going to come is aberrant, art and identity. This is, many people really want to be different. It is because they do not fit into the skin they live in. This lady has developed something called carnal art, that the way she was, she said, my work is not a standing, you know. It is, and I think before long we'll find many people who really will come and they want to change their face because they want to be different. So aberrant, and finally, of course, the new technology is bringing great possibilities. I just thought I will show you, this is the face transplant where from a person who was brain dead was removed and put, I know this French surgeon, the French team which did it. It is, and there are a lot of ethical issues which come into it. And of course, with all the new things that are coming into us, it is possible that before long we have to adapt ourselves to a sort of a bionic feature. That's why I think art, already movie is doing a great job of sensitizing people to the possibility that there will be people going with different sort of things which do not fit into our idea of a human being. So I will end with, now that I see, and what he says afterwards is even more interesting. He says, their thoughts are someone else's opinions, their lives a mimicry, and their passions a quotation. So I think I will stop at that. What I really try to do is give you a sort of an overview of it. This, we could have gone into different ways. We could have discussed it from the standpoint of neurophysiology and psychology. We could have discussed, but I tried to look at it as an artist and a physician rather than as a scientist, because I wanted it to be a general perspective. Thank you very much indeed.
Well, thank you for that wonderful presentation. And I'm sure there are a lot of questions that you want to ask. And I must say, like, you should actually come to a Harvard Humanities Project and talk to us and inspire undergraduate students who study humanities and who want to be in medicine. is there any question for Dr. Salins?
Is a parallel between a particular reconstruction of a face or a particular reconstitution of a face? Is that connected? Is there an art component to each particular surgery, or is it just separate parallel hobbies that are pursued?
Yeah,
in some sense, hobbies is the wrong word, but interests that are pursued in parallel and somehow inform each other in the recesses of your mind.
Yes. The trick of, I did not go into that. What I really wanted to point out that understanding what somebody else's perception is, if you did not understand and you changed his face or her face, is a disaster.
Yeah.
No matter how good you may think it is, the patient will say it is disaster. And I mean, many a surgeon. And neurologically speaking, of course, we have empathetic neurons. There is a theory of man. That's why in autism, for instance, children do not have a capacity because there is no neurons which resonate. I think in a facial surgery, to really develop a comprehension of what is really happening, you have to train your mind to develop that perception so you understand why and what is it that the other person is asking. And that, I think, it will be always an art.
Okay. I do volunteer work as an anesthesiologist in India with a team that does facial surgery. And frequently we'll have teenagers to mature adults who've lived with a cleft lip all their life and they get a repair. They're always very happy in the first few days afterwards, but then I have no concept of how they feel 6 months or a year later. Do you have any experience with this kind of thing?
Yes. See, I mean, I did not put many people really suffer a great deal. You will be amazed. Now I'm doing craniosynostosis, for instance.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, a great deal. I did not put it and. Much to my horror, I found that many families do not let the children come out because they do not want them to be seen. So I think we have a huge number of highly tortured children who are sort of, the family does not want to admit that they exist and they suffer. That's why even if our repair is not the best, even in the case of cleft lip and palate, I think it gives self-respect. I remember Paul Brand speaking about leprosy patients. You see, usually leprosy patients are recognized because they lose all their hair. And the trick is to take a little scalp, make an island flap, and create a thing like that. So if the hair comes, Chris keeps going. And one day he said, a patient came, the hair had gone so much that it was literally covering his vision and eyes. He said, this is crazy. Why are you having this like this? He said, no, I have suffered so much, people saying that I don't have hair, because of that I have leprosy, that I want everybody to know that my leprosy is gone, you see. So I think it makes a tremendous difference.
Well, just to, on the subject of cleft palate surgery, I mean, it's not just an aesthetic question at all. I mean, cleft palate results in many dysfunctions.
Absolutely.
Of speaking, of even nourishing oneself, especially a
yes.
baby, of
yes.
sucking,
yes.
Articulation, etc. So it can't help but benefit the person,
and
normalize the person to have
yeah.
that corrected, even if it's not perfect and even in some way they're attached to their old appearance. I know I was very nonchalant about my son's. It wasn't for surgery, but I mean, as far as I was concerned, he looked just fine.
But he was very accusatory toward me because he said, well, he didn't, you know, he looked like he had had cleft palate, which of course was the case. So he did have the surgery. I don't think it changed him that much, but.
Yeah. But in adults, speech and things like that do not improve so much once after 7 years. But aesthetic correction, I think, is very important, I feel. Yeah.
Yeah, my question was about people who have their lips repaired as teenagers or adults, and you know, they've lived
so
with
that.
So
you're saying that they've perception adapted
for so long
to that, and
then how does
change
it,
is not that great.
How do they feel in a few months?
Yeah.
I never see that.
I think you really make a great difference to their lives, and really, see, many of these people, somebody coming and telling them they can be cured or at least helped, you know, even the communication that you do with them becomes very meaningful. I think I enjoy working with them because I like to talk to them, and you know, the sort of gratefulness and I think it's a tremendous intrinsic reward you feel, because you really feel that somebody has at last tried to meet their need.
If I may interject some questions, I must sort of say that you are a great artist yourself, and that's why I think you are actually able to do this. The model that you propose, sort of bringing art back into science or bringing art and science together, I wonder how it can be actually institutionalized. I mean, I think it's possible because it's you, in a way, that you can actually, you are bringing this together in a position. And is that a model that can be actually replicated elsewhere? Can you sort of, have you been thinking about what kind of model will actually bring this change in medical practice overall? That's one question. And I was sort of kind of inspired by how you actually use the art to actually bring the community that you're working with in your hospital together, and wonder if you can actually talk more about that aspect of your sort of using the art to build a community, medical community that you're working with in a way. So,
I think we have enough basis from neuropsychology and in cognitive sciences to develop a very, very vibrant program for creating, as I different generative orders of it is, and getting people interested. I really think till now probably our understanding of the implications of art was probably inadequate for us to make a whole set of things. Because we consider art as being a part and something up there or down there, be it as it, we still have not actually made the connection. I really think that you can create a very systematic approach to clinical medicine itself. So let's consider medicine or engineering for that matter, which will improve the cognitive processes, give sensitivity. And since we understand so much about perceptions and which part of the brain responds to what, for instance, the face has a separate cortical area, it is possible to really stimulate and create. I think, for instance, a student coming to study business management, he started drawing a picture, and which had certain degree of generative orders. And then you see over the period as he matures, how he is given an opportunity to go back into it and keep on adding. You probably might find a very interesting development, you know, which resonates with the maturity he is or she is developing. And that could be a very interesting way of making people realize that it is, and that will create a... And secondly, also, I feel that with all the prosperity and all that, these things, certainly in developing countries, people's ability to enjoy life, to really have values goes, because they don't have an interest. It is so violence increases. Part of it is that there is absolutely nothing beautiful in their whole life. So they actually go into sort of violence and doing hideous things. And I think from in school, and certainly in early college, if people are inculcated with an appreciation of beauty and also of its value as a substrate for creative thought, I think it will change the dynamics into a creative, and certainly narrative. See, the whole brain processes work, particularly when you want paradigm shifts. When you have to make completely from one tacit infrastructure of ideas into another completely leap. For instance, if you really consider in Aristotle's idea of the of everything being having a space of its own, you know, the heavenly bodies are up there and we are here and nothing is connected, so, and everything comes to a state of rest. When Newton came, you see, the paradigm shift was completely different, it's completely opposite. And he said that a state of rest is a special state. So every paradigm shift brings completely contradictory or conflicting ideas into the things. And that is why art is so very important to prepare the mind for such leaps of thought. So I think there is a we are now very happy in medicine. Many people are going for engineering together. I think the Harvard program of combining MIT, and it is a fantastic way of doing it, because whether we like it or not, ultimately, I was telling Charles today that I think the future would be that, you know, part of the doctors will have to become engineers, part of the engineers will have to become doctors, and we have to integrate it. Similarly with art.
And can you comment on your practice with the creating art and the community?
I all the time experiment with art because I enjoy doing it. But I go through phases. For 2 years, it would be art, and after 2 years, maybe it will be music or theology or anything. So it, I do not take myself very seriously because it's I go through phases. But now it is the art phase. So.
I'm curious, specifically in your cosmetic surgeries, do you work from a kind of impression of what the ideal is that you're aiming toward, or do you use mathematical formulae, do you use computer simulations? I just wondered how you did that. A few years ago, there was a BBC series on beauty, they meant Pulcher to you, mainly. It was mainly, the last episodes anyway, were mainly about feminine beauty. And they just went, they had an idée fixe about the golden mean. And in fact, there was a talent or a beauty contest, and the winner, they went through demonstrating that she evinced the golden mean in so many of her facial features. The interesting thing, however, was that she had the most irregular teeth I've ever seen in my life, and apparently they didn't apply the golden mean to that. But I mean, it seemed to me that really what was attracted to this girl, and I read the comments, that online comments about the program, was the extreme neoteny, or the fact that she looked like a baby, really, and yet she was, in some sense, a mature woman. And I think that's ideologically very problematic. So I don't know if you want to comment on
that. We have mathematical norms, but at the end of the day, mathematical ideas, we have several. Sometimes, you see, the main philosophy in all this is to look for averageness.
Yeah.
You know, I think in any evidence-based process, we always look for averageness because that is the low-hanging fruit.
And there's
that
symmetry too, right?
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. And everything you sort of average it is, and you can get a fairly harmonious face by creating an average. But if you really want to make something, I think sometimes you have to incorporate a degree of asymmetry, because that's what actually makes something interesting. And other day I operated on one of the most boring girls you can imagine. And while I finished it, she was sulking the next day. I really thought what she needs is a new soul, because ultimately, you know, what really makes you attractive is not the symmetry of the face, but I think something much more than that. So I put her on antidepressants.
Before or after the operation?
Actually, I was a little wicked. I started before, so that she will have a feel-good factor afterwards.
I was just going to make an interesting comment that First of all, the picture that you put up by Egon Shelley,
mm-hmm.
It's the portrait of Vali, which is a wonderful
yes.
piece. And last night I watched a documentary about the portrait of Vali. And if you do, mm-mm. you probably can download it or watch it, but I think it would be very interesting for you to see what happened to the picture mm-hmm. after he painted it. And it went through several historical and was looted, and poor Vali had a bad life. Anyway, last week I was at a conference of 500 dermatologists. And they're not surgeons like you are, but they do a lot of facial changes.
Yeah.
And so there was a faculty dinner. And I was curious to see whether or not the wives of the dermatologists, many of them were male, whether or not how they looked, you know? And in fact, I was sitting at a table with 8 or 9 dermatologists and their wives, and they all looked quite wonderful. And clearly, I mean, I'm married to a neuroradiologist, so there's no hope for me. But it was clear that the impetus to change one's face, whether or not to be aesthetically more perfect, more symmetrical, or simply younger, was quite remarkable. And so I thought maybe I should have married a dermatologist or perhaps a plastic surgeon. But and then one final question. The Narayana Hospital and Devi Shetty and his team have a wonderful reputation in terms of how the organization functions, both in terms of quality and efficiency. And I'm wondering if you are able to integrate and do some teaching to build that culture and to enhance it, because you're such a wonderful teacher. And I'm wondering if you're able to, you probably don't have time, but if it would be so wonderful for you to provide this kind of insight and integration of ideas that would strengthen the community of medicine.
Yeah, like any new venture which is rapidly expanding, all of us are. I think when I come here, I think I'm able to. Normally, the day-to-day work of running an institution and just keeping it going occupies a great deal of your creative energy, I think. Yeah. In fact, I sort of prepared this, I think on the flight, and then put them together. But what you say is very true. It is to philosophically challenge people. And I think in art history, I think it is very important that a course or some sort of this one is created, which makes a number of different disciplines. It adds a new dimension and a possibility. I think it is doable. And there is, teaching neurophysiology, psychology, and integrating art. It can really change the perception. Ultimately, even in any negotiation, ultimately it is a sort of perception, a heightened perception, which is so very important, or in law. I really think that is a doable thing, and I don't think we've exploited it sufficiently.
In fact, the Harvard Medical School just recently put together a course for the students on art.
Oh, I'm delighted.
Yeah, so, it's taken decades mm-mm. for this to come about, but for the first time, they're now doing medicine and art as a course.
Fantastic, yeah.
Can I ask just put a little bit of critical sort of question here, that sort of thinking about cosmetic surgery, especially when you showed us the pictures that you were looking at to suggest a face to somebody, and it's sort of mind-boggling to think that you can actually suggest a face to somebody. But the images that you showed us and sort of the perfect symmetry and beauty, that the conception of beauty that's sort of embodied in Judy's works are all sort of European art-based and, you know, sort of Western ideal. And in this global age, we sort of have to also think about the local context and sort of local regional identity and what's the beauty in certain society versus sort of universalizing sort of transcendental concept of beauty. And I feel like, you know, neuroscience and sort of scientific inquiry into sort of the brain, the way a human brain works, often sort of sublimate everything into sort of pure scientific mode of just numbers, and that sort of does not seem to allow any sort of local, you know, regional sort of ideas about, different ideas about beauty in a way that might not be actually explained through symmetry or any ratio of numbers or golden number. So I wonder if you sort of can think of it.
Many times, I mean, we have to vary the our philosophy significantly. For instance, if you created, for the Malayali population in India, if you just flatten their face, they immediately look very old. In fact, I made this colossal mistake when I was a student, and I have enough suffered greatly by that. And that that lady, I thought she looked fantastic according to my ideal, but she said, "No, you made me look old." In fact, right now I got one young lady who wants her face to be taken back to what she was before. Not, I did not do the surgery. Somebody else had done. But she says she wants to go back to the old shape. So I think this is a very critical factor. I think our understanding is increasing about the way people perceive things, and that can be developed.
So what are the... how do you deal with ethical issues when somebody comes to you, like in that case, and says, I mean, are there any ethical issues I don't even know? And somebody says, I want that, and I used to be that, somebody made me this, and I want to be that. How does one think through?
Well, they can actually sue the doctor for huge amounts of money, provided the doctor did not inform them, and it was many times, you see. In fact, we have to be very, very, very careful about how we do. Particularly, unless you charge the patient an arm and a leg, they are bound to. It is such a terrible specialty. I must confess that I don't do aesthetic. I'm not an aesthetic surgeon. I'm essentially a cancer reconstructive surgeon. I dabble in aesthetic surgery whenever I find somebody really interesting. If somebody comes and laughs and in my office and it is, then I will agree to operate. But I don't normally do. Normally my work is in cancer surgery, where the issues are very serious. But I find that, in any endeavor, mixing it with a little bit of this one, and also helps me keep a certain sensitivity to the cancer patient, because you always, with cancer reconstruction, you tend to do the worst possible for them. I think it is the most archaic method of reconstruction ever. I don't think it has evolved in the last 100 years.
Sorry, I missed that. What is the archaic part of it?
The overall way in which we view cancer reconstruction. It's not modeling based. There is no prototyping. There is no directly. You have so many flaps, and you see which one fits, and it is just like, you know, having a large library, I mean, large wardrobe with so many things. You just fit one flap or the other flap. There is absolutely no philosophy of kinematics or function or anything in that. In fact, it's pathetic.
So cancer patients, you just have to save them and just somehow put them together,
Because you save them, you think that you've done a great job, but very often you save them and leave them hideous.
Should we?
Oh,
thank you.
Oh.
I
have
one more.
Yes, please.
Mic more?
This uses the mic.
So this concept of art and medicine is something I've been thinking about for some time. And I was wondering if, in your case, it, the two are things that developed separately for you. I know I understand that you studied art history, but at what point did you see the possible connection between these two, and what meaning did that have for you through your medical training?
Mm. So medicine, I always consider it an art. In fact, I think I'm painfully aware that we are losing our identity, it is. But I'm as a pragmatic reality, I also think that technology probably will have to sort of substantial portion of the role of the medicine, and it keep to people, it is. But I really think that art, I have always been very conscious of the fact that it is possible to enhance the capacity for appreciation and sensitivity. And I think it is a biological fact that you can really teach people to appreciate beauty and knowledge. And also, so I make a great, I always was aware of that, and I have always tried to nurture that very, very early. And to me, even when I select a postgraduate student, I ask them, if I find that even if they are the highest grades, if they have absolutely no interest in poetry or literature, I don't normally take him because he will bore me.
Thank you.
A great human makes a great doctor. Okay, so, well, thank you. Thank you all for coming.